Anybody know who lives in Old Wilshire Farm? Because they've got horses.
Katie and that encouraging, and Maddie Bentham. Hey, I don't know, is Maddie here this morning? she's not. Okay, so congratulations to Maddie too. She's off to Ferris as well. I can't, my glasses are a little hidden. Okay, good. So much congratulations to our graduates. Please bless them. Pray for the teachers. Pray for all those that are going on to do something next. And wow, very cool. Hey, also another quick announcement for our church family. Just want to thanks to Dan Vilwalk and Lars Verdeen for last Friday. They helped out over at the Dottie House, and we built 95% of the deck there. We still got to screw some deck boards down and do some other stuff, but much thanks to that. And I just want to thank everybody that gave generously to building that deck for the Dotties. And part of it was just an opportunity to connect with Sarah and Mike. And Friday, right after Lars and Dan left, we were just wrapping up, I was loading up some tools, and Sarah came out of her room, and we talked, and we prayed. And I asked her, hey, are you and Jesus okay? Do you know where you're going if this horrible cancer wins? And she goes, absolutely, I know where I'm going. So just the joy of having that conversation it was very cool. So just want to say thank you to you as a church for all those that volunteered and helped with that process. So it was very cool. Hey, yesterday, Jake and Maria Cook got married. Amen. It was beautiful. It was my first COVID-19 wedding and hopefully the last. I mean, hopefully there's my wedding. But we had 12 people. And we had a surprise best man show up, so we had to add one. We had 11, so we were just over the 10 rule, but it was a little surreal holding a wedding without a full house, but God was kind to Jake and Maria, so we're gonna pray for them a bit later too. Also, again, please pray for our country and all the cities right now that are wrestling with the anger and the hurt over George Floyd's horrible death and the incident that took place. So please pray for our country and the law enforcement and just everybody. It's terrible out there right now. Yes, and also the Highland, we have such a beautiful church. So the flowers outside, if you'd like to volunteer to help take care of those, pick some dead ones once in a while, water them. I know there's sign-up sheets. Please contact Sarah. Am I missing any other announcements? Anything else that I want to say? Thank you all for being here this morning, and we hope our time of worship is blessed. I'd like to read the story of Pentecost a sec. Tim, could you put that next slide up from Acts 2, 1 to 6? This morning is Pentecost Sunday, and I just want to quickly read the story of Pentecost and remember how powerful the Holy Spirit is in our lives. So let's read the text together. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting, the disciples, the apostles. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And when they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language. And we'll say that as the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pentecost Sunday. You know, every Sunday, as we've said before, is a mini Easter, and we celebrate God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But today is a special Sunday, 50 days after the resurrection, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Maybe it's ascension. I got it mixed up for a second. Yes, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And then, forgive me, that we are celebrating Pentecost and that the Holy Spirit has come down and becomes Jesus' representative on earth. So every pain you feel, everything that you have, every longing in your heart, the Holy Spirit knows and listens and ushers up into the throne room of God. So praise God for the Holy Spirit this morning. And we're going to talk more about that. So brothers and sisters in Christ, will you please stand? Let's say together what Christians have said throughout the centuries. Ready? Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Receive God's greeting. Grace, Mercy and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And all God's people said,
Amen.
We pray for a cure, we pray for hope, we pray for Now the numbers, Lord, who knows exactly, but if there's 100,000 deaths from this in our country, we pray, Lord, that that stops, that that number goes down, and that we don't have any more deaths in this world, and that in our country and across the world, that, Lord, there's so many different ways to look at the numbers, and it's so confusing and scary and all that sort of stuff, and yet, Lord, we don't live in fear, and so for many of us, help us not to live in fear, but to make life normal as possible. There's this constant balance and tension as we swing back and forth in our hearts and minds. And so please, Lord, help us all to give grace to each other as we navigate these turbulent, murky, gray waters, as we try to move forward and be the family of God as best as we are able. Lord, we ask that you be with the Floyd family right now and in the loss of their son, George. Comfort them and surround them, and Lord, what chaos has ensued across our country, and protests and riots and fires and burnings and rubber bullets and deaths and pain and suffering. Oh, Lord, we pray for healing and reconciliation. Again, we pray for forgiveness. We pray for justice. We pray for the law enforcement officers, we pray for conviction of unwise choices by law enforcement officers. Just so many things, Lord, again, that seem to be divisive in our country, both in politics and in individual hearts. So, Lord, we pray for all those that want to protest peacefully. We pray for those that are venting their anger in unhealthy ways. And we just pray for our country, Lord. And we pray for unity and hope and calm and peace in hearts as well. Lord, we want to give you thanks that Jake and Maria could get married here yesterday. Bless their marriage. Lord, every marriage is a reminder of our own marriage with our spouses and for those of us that are, but also our marriage in sense with you, O God, a marriage with our church and a marriage with people that we really care about. Lord, so please bless their relationship. Help Jake and Maria not to follow those eight traps we talked about last week, and help them to flourish and continue to love each other and fill them with joy. Lord, if you so desire and they want to bless them with children, help them to fall in love with you and grow in the wisdom and knowledge of their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, bind them together with joy and grace. Lord, we just ask that you be with our graduates this morning, be with Katie Maiden-Dorp and her next steps, and bless her, oh God, help her to flourish in whatever she's pursuing. Thank you that she could graduate. Bless Dale and Kim as well. And so bless Katie, sorry if I said Kim before. Lord God, please be with Randy Bentham as she ventures off to Ferris. Please be with her. Please be with Jason and Sherry, too, as they think about our daughter, and pray for them as they head off. And it's a blessing, and it's sad, too, because it's your little girl as they venture off into a new life and new beginnings and different rhythms. So, Lord, comfort them and be with them. Please bless Maddie. Lord, help Maddie to fall in love with you every single day. Help her and Jesus to connect, and help her to be the godly woman that you want her to be. Lord, we ask that you be with Drew this morning and bless him too as he heads off to Ferris as well. And bless Drew Vanna and help him to continue to flourish. Be with Kathy and Gary as they think about their first son heading off to college, and it's a different rhythm now at their household. So bless Kathy and her work and Gary and his, and give them too the wisdom and the discernment to navigate these new family dynamics and rhythms and feelings. And the little boy is going off to college, Lord, so please bless them and surround them with your comfort and grace. Lord, also with Drew, help him to fall in love with Jesus and to have a great relationship with him and to make wise choices, as so many things are different in college and there's so much more independence and in some ways less accountability. So please be with him and comfort him also. Lord, we ask that you continue to be with our new babies that are born in our church. Please be with Asher Sluter. Bless him, O God. Help him to grow up to be a follower of your son, Jesus, too. Help him to fall in love with you. And continue to bless Justin and Sarah as they raise their beautiful two children now. And you, O God, bless them. Bless their family. Help Asher to be healthy and strong. Lord, please also be with Michael Kovacnik this morning. Give him energy and grace too. Please be with Jason and Anita and their family as they continue to raise their kids as best they can. Help Michael to also fall in love with you, Jesus, and to just to know and have a great relationship with you. Lord, we ask that you be with our church family this morning also. Please be with Joe Magendorf, continue to heal his heart. Please be with Mary Lou Karsten as we're looking into pain shots now. And Lord, we pray for the pain in her back and help it to be gone. Help her to be able to sit for a while and lay down for a while. Just those simple things that we take for granted. Please comfort Mary Lou and be with her. Lord, thank you that Pearl could be here again this morning. Thank you for her to continue to be with her heart, and if she chooses to have more surgery, bless Pearl, O God, and give her wisdom and grace. Please be with her and continue to be with her and blessing her for so many years and days on this earth. We just want to thank you for that. And Lord, we ask that you be with my grandma this morning, who fell in Grand Rapids, and it's the second fall, and be with my dad and my uncles and my aunts as they think about what's the next step for her if she needs assisted care and can no longer live on her own. Lord, thank you for almost 96 years in her life right now, and please continue to bless my grandma and keep her safe. Lord, we ask that you be with Steve Sluter this morning. Continue to be with Steve and Becky. Surround them with your love and your grace, especially with Becky's concern about the virus shipping so many things from all over the world and being in the warehouse and the driving truck and all that. Just comfort her and be with her and be with Steve's need too, O God. Lord, we ask that you be with Dick Bruno this morning. We know that he's in constant pain still, and some of the hardware in his back has come loose. So please help his upcoming surgery to fix that and to take away the pain in his life. Please be with Mary too, and the kids and grandkids and the dog and all that stuff, Lord. Please bless the Bruno family. Lord, please continue to be with Marilyn, her heart and her hearing. Please be with her. Help her to continue to flourish as she worships online, and please be with her and comfort her and surround her with your love and grace. Lord, we ask that you be with Mike and Sarah Dowdy. Lord, we're so thankful that Mike can be more mobile, be with his children, be with Eli as he's figuring out what he's going to do next with his life. Be with the rest of their family too, if they're hurting and have their own troubles going on. Lord, please be with Mike's leg as the part that was amputated is not healing as fast as it should be. So please be with him and help him to get out of that wheelchair. Lord, we're thankful that we as a church had an opportunity to comfort Sarah Dowdy on Friday, and to know, Lord, that she's praying every single day for a miracle in her life, and that she turns to your son Jesus every single day, and that she is praying and wrestling and struggling and wants to find a cure. And so we pray, Lord, right now that the melanoma cancer drug that she is on right now, that the rest of her cancer in her body would think it's melanoma and react to that and somehow grant her at least another 5 or 6 years on this earth as she fights that cancer off. And Lord, every experimental treatment has not gone well. The cancer, the radiation, and all that stuff has not gone well, and it's just a continual daily struggle for her. And the pain. And Lord, we're so thankful that we could build a deck as a church family, and it went well, and that she even said she can't even do stairs with that. And so we're so thankful for the wheelchair ramp that so many others built earlier. And now this, may this be a blessing to them. And may this be an encouragement that the body of Christ is there for the Dowdies, and that we can continue to reach out to them in simple ways, in loving ways, in kind ways. So please bless them, O God. Lord, we also ask that you be with folks right now in our church family, that there are so many other needs that we haven't prayed about. Continue to be with Dale Ferdin as he recovers from his prostate surgery. Help that to go really, really well. Please be with Faye too, as maybe some extra help around the house is needed right now, and as different weights can't be lifted and all that stuff. So please, please bless Dale and Faye as they continue to navigate what that looks like. And we pray, Lord, that the blood work comes back and that the cancer is far removed from his body and that it hasn't spread anywhere. And that you keep Dale safe and well and good and continue to bless him on your good earth. Lord, we want to pray for Lynn and Sandy Rice as they think about what to do next this summer and when the border is going to open for them in Canada. Lord, give them the calm and the peace and to know that they're blessed here too, but also to look forward to heading back to their friends and those they care about in Canada. They can take some time away for some good rest. So please bless them and keep them safe and help the borders to reopen when they can and for our country to find a more semblance of rhythm as well. Lord, I know there's probably other prayer requests that I'm missing, and please forgive me for that, for those that want prayer. But we lay all those things at your feet right now. We ask that you continue to bless our church as we give generously in our tithe boxes, our joy boxes in the back. We pray for giving online. We pray for, again, and for all those that have given to the tithe box in the office. Thank you, Lord, for the continuing generosity of this church. And so, Lord, as we hear your word now, we ask that you open up our hearts and our minds. We ask that you, Holy Spirit, on your Pentecost Sunday, that you move among us and stir our hearts to a deepening relationship with your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for all the ministries right now that maybe aren't happening at our church that we wish they could, with children's programs and worship and fellowship and Bible studies and all those things that we're used to. Lord, we pray for all those rhythms and needs that aren't being met. Please comfort them. And Lord, continue to be with our council and our staff, and please bless them too as they make wise decisions. So as we continue to worship, O God, again, calm our hearts, open our spirit, help us to focus on you. And Holy Spirit, thank you for being here this morning, even in our prayer. And in Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Next week, I think we're going to have the Bibles back in the pew. If you have one on your phone or want to follow along, we're going to be reading from Acts 9, starting at 19b, which is the second half of verse 19, and reading through verse 31 in a moment. So this is our last week now in church membership, looking at church membership through the Belgian Confession in the Bible. And so far, God has measured out all sorts of gifts, a gift by the Holy Spirit, for this morning on Pentecost Sunday. What a great reminder. We were also encouraged to preach the gospel. Peter and John preached the gospel. They tried to change what was going on in a very difficult Jewish culture. We are also called to encourage one another, to look around us as the family of God, and to encourage each other and support each other no matter what happens as the body of Christ. And last week, we reminded that church membership is very much like a marriage, where all of us can fall into sorts of different traps and different things, but at the same time, during which Jesus is rebuilding each of our hearts. He has become the cornerstone of each of our hearts. And since today is Pentecost Sunday, let's look at what's going on in the early church. We're going to look at what the Holy Spirit is doing in Saul's life. Is Saul and Paul, same person, because Saul changed his name to Paul, so I'm going to use the name Saul this morning for Paul. We're going to look at what's going on in Saul and Paul's life as the Holy Spirit is working, and maybe we can discern a rhythm or a pattern of what God is doing in his church all the time, everywhere. So let's read the text together, Acts 9, starting at verse 19. Saul spent several days with the disciples in Damascus. At once, he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. All those who heard him were astonished and asked, well, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on his name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests? Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled at the Jews living in Damascus and proving that Jesus is the Christ. So they were baffled. So after many days, had gone by, the Jews conspired to kill him. But Saul learned of their plan. Day and night they kept close watch on the city gates in order to kill him. But his followers took him by night and lowered him in a basket through an opening in the wall. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul, on his journey, had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Grecian Jews, and they tried to kill him. And when the brothers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace. It was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit. It grew in numbers, living in fear of the Lord. The word of the Lord. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie or read the book Seabiscuit. Anybody? Horse movie? No? Yes? One? Two? Not many? Okay. A couple people have. Well, just, it's one of the greatest horse race stories in the history of the world. Well, the history of horse racing, I should say. Maybe not the history of the world, because I don't know the history of the world that well. Seabiscuit, the name of the one horse, raced against War Admiral, the other horse. And War Admiral was a Triple Crown winner. I think he won a bunch of derbies to become a Triple Crown winner. And the heavy favorite. And the author said that Seabiscuit's longtime jockey, Red Pollard, could not ride Seabiscuit because of an injury. So he got a replacement, and his replacement was George the Iceman Wolf. And he gave advice, Red did, to Wolf, on how to run the race that defied conventional wisdom. So Red told him, have Seabiscuit jump out to the lead, Pollard told Wolf. But then when War Admiral, the heavy favorite, launches his final drive for the wire, do something completely unexpected and let him catch up. This went all against common sense, but Pollard said it was a case of horse psychology. Once a horse gives Seabiscuit the old look in the eye, Pollard said, Seabiscuit begins to run to parts unknown. War Admiral, the other horse, has speed, really good speed, speed when unopposed. But with Seabiscuit, you could kill him before he quit. It's not in his feet, George. It's in his heart. So according to the author, the whole country assembled around the radios. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, FDR, put off a cabinet meeting to listen to the race. One of the famous races in our country. The bell rang, the race began. And this morning, the race begins for Saul, the disciples, and his church. First, there's very much trouble in Damascus. There's trouble in Damascus. First, perfect. What's your word? Picture of old-time Damascus. You know, one of the marks, again, between the true church and the false church, according to the Belgian Confession, is the pure preaching of the gospel. Saul does just that in verse 20, and it causes Saul all sorts of problems, and it partly has to do with his past. So in the first 19 and a half verses of our text in chapter 9 that we didn't read, here's what's going on. It happens again to do with his past. Paul is confronted by a resurrected Jesus on his road to Damascus. Jesus asked him, Saul, why do you persecute me? Since Saul, in Saul's past, was the chief persecutor of Christians, Jesus' question is that much more meaningful. So prior to his conversion, Saul had the power to arrest any Jew that he saw that spoke the name of Jesus or belonged to that following called the Way. Saul was the chief persecutor of Christians in ancient times. Next, Jesus strikes Saul on the road to Damascus with blindness and leads him to the disciple, Ananias. So after Ananias receives some divine encouragement from Jesus himself, he says that Saul will be seen again, and the text says, filled with the Holy Spirit. In short, Saul was transformed. He could see again, and he got baptized into the name of Jesus. So that's what happens just prior to our text. Now here's the interesting part. The text says in 19b that Saul spent several days in Damascus. That is an understatement in the text. Because Paul, formerly known as Saul in our text, in Galatians 1, says this. Check, this is crazy. For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism. This is Paul, who's also Saul. He is saying this. How intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age, among my peers, among my people, and I was extremely zealous for the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being. I did not go up to Jerusalem to see those who were apostles before I was, but I went to Arabia, and later I returned to Damascus. That's where our text begins. Then the text says, then after 3 years, I went to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Cephas, who was Peter, and stayed with him for 15 days. For 3 years, Paul preached all over Damascus. Paul preached over a heavily cultured Jewish people in Damascus, right? There was a synagogue on every single corner at that time in Damascus. Kind of like Grand Rapids today. You can't drive down to Grand Rapids in the kind of the main sector. There's churches on every corner, it seems like, in Grand Rapids. And Saul preached scandal. He preached that Jesus was the Son of God. That is not going to get him in the good graces of the Jewish people. Good. Preach scandal. Even the Jews were shocked by this turn of events. The text says that Saul baffled the Jews. Baffled them nonstop. Because of his training and knowledge of Scripture, Saul kept proving and showing and sharing that Jesus was the Messiah for the Jewish people, right from the Old Testament and now into his time. That had to be infuriating. Oh, did that make people mad? Jesus can't be God's son or thinker or Messiah. He came from Nazareth. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? No. Jesus can't be the Messiah. Plus, wouldn't that make him divine? That doesn't make sense. Verse 23 says, after many days, and I would add years, there was a conspiracy among the Jews to kill Saul. The Belgian Confession also says that the false church will persecute those who live holy lives according to the word of God. And in a sense, the Jews in our text have become the false church now. And Saul and his followers and the disciples are the true church. I love the courage of Saul in our text. Instead of hanging out with Gentiles or finding an easy place to preach or hanging out in Arabia, or, you know, he could have gone to the Gentiles first, but he goes back to Damascus. The Holy Spirit placed and Saul picked and knew the one place he would get persecuted. He wanted to face the trouble head on. He wanted to let War Admiral sort of catch up with him and kind of look him in the eye and see what's going to happen next. It's like he reveled in the confidence and the comfort and the safety of Jesus. Okay, what's God going to do here? And who knows how long that kill order was in place on Saul. Could have been years. Daily, Saul risked death walking around the city of Damascus, going to synagogue to synagogue to preach that Jesus is the Son of God. Saul knew what happened to Stephen. Earlier, remember Stephen? Saul knew that the kill order was very real because Saul had Stephen killed, but Saul trusted that God would provide a way for him to keep preaching the gospel. Saul and his followers knew life wasn't going to be easy following Jesus, but they had to keep on running the race. So his followers, as the text says, took him by night, lowered him in a basket through an opening in a wall, because these walls were huge, but sometimes the houses and the rooftops stuck above the walls. So they probably lowered him out a high window in somebody's house near the wall, and he escaped to his fellow Christians. And second, there's also trouble in Jerusalem. The trouble doesn't stop. It seems the persecutions still do not stop. From the beginning of his Jerusalem tour, the disciples are afraid of Saul. His reputation preceded him there as well. How many of the disciples thought, oh, that's Saul. He's just really a secret agent. He's gonna worm his way in good with the disciples. He's going to call in the Jewish temple guard. He's going to get us all arrested and killed. That Saul, he's a sneaky one, that guy. Man, he is crazy. He's going to kill us. It was so difficult to forget Saul's past. You know, during COVID-19 so far, my wife, with some help from Barb Lee and Linda Wing, got me hooked on a show called When Calls the Heart. Some people are laughing. Has anyone seen the show or heard the show? Yeah, When Calls the Heart. It is about a small town in Canada named Hope Valley. It's a frontier town that is trying to grow. And it's also a romance story between a Canadian Mountie and a school teacher. I think it's a Hallmark show. Is that right? Is it a Hallmark? It's a Canadian show, but it's made in Canada by the CBC, but it's not a Hallmark show. Okay, so got it. So anyway, so what struck me is watching this show, and it's all right. There's a pastor in the show called Pastor Frank. I'm like, oh, there's a pastor in the show. That's cool. I gotta see what's going on with this guy. And when the good townspeople of Hope Valley find out that Pastor Frank in his past life is a convicted felon, used to like rob banks, and he was a demolition expert and blew up safes and stuff, there's an uproar in the town. They try to drive him out. They try to get rid of him because, like Saul, they just can't trust he's a changed man. So a character named Abigail steps in and vouches for Pastor Frank. And this happens to Saul in our text. Barnabas steps up and he shares Saul's story, and he assures everyone that no, Saul is preaching the gospel, and he frees up Saul to do ministry. But still, even in Jerusalem, the Hellenistic Jews also wanted to kill him. It doesn't stop. When the gospel is preached, it will stir up trouble. That's a rhythm in a pattern all the time in the church. One author said that Saul's preaching was so frustrating, they were helpless in debate and resorted to violence. Kind of fits in our, we're so frustrated with what happened with George Floyd, it just resulted in violence. He continues, no one persecutes a man who is ineffective and who obviously doesn't matter. George Bernard Shaw, the same guy is quoting this, he once said that the biggest compliment you can pay an author is to burn his books. Someone has said, I think Hitler did this all the time, not only with the Bible, but with thousands and thousands of books. Someone has said a wolf will never attack a painted sheep. Counterfeit Christianity is always safe. Real Christianity is always in peril. Always in peril. To suffer persecution is to be paid the greatest of compliments, because it is certain proof that people think you really matter. But it's not just one person. Every Christian, all of you, myself, every Christian matters. Because when you wear a mask, or you don't wear a mask, people watch how you respond and represent the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you are sick of being quarantined and you are practicing social distance, how you respond reveals a path of love toward Jesus or away from Jesus. How we talk about, again, President Trump or Governor Whitmer or people we like or don't like or disagree with is how we represent the true church or the false church. And if we, the church, like Saul, keep living fearlessly in the name of Jesus, there will be pushback. And that's okay. That's okay. Satan and the world do not want peace in the land. They don't. They don't. They want fear. They want anger. They want frustration. And if fear is in the land, then what happens? God is forgotten. The gospel is forgotten. The Holy Spirit this morning is forgotten. And it's a false comfort. And if we distract ourselves with social media and money and that false comfort, the false church, when War Admiral pulls up alongside of us and the fear seems bigger and stronger and impossible to overcome, what is the next step? What do we do? And I think the answer is in our third point. It is this: to trust in the Holy Spirit. Look at all the crucial moments in Saul's life at this point. Remember again that Saul was there at the stoning of Stephen. In Acts 8 verse 1 it says this: and Saul approved of their killing Stephen. They stoned him, took him out back, and as they were stoning him, the Holy Spirit was also working in Saul's heart. When Saul heard Stephen's amazing speech while he was being killed, the Holy Spirit was working when Saul heard Stephen's vision into heaven. The Holy Spirit was working when Stephen cried out, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them," as he's being killed by Saul and the Jewish leaders. There's another moment in Saul's life with Ananias. On the road to Damascus, God used Ananias to not only heal Saul from blindness, but to fill Saul with the Holy Spirit to change his life forever. And I wonder, they had for sure, both Saul and Ananias, talked about, commiserated, shared, "Hey, Jesus said this to me on the road to Damascus." You hear Ananias, "Oh, Jesus came to me and talked to me about, I have to bless you." That's crazy. And they shared their stories about what Jesus had done for them. And then it was Barnabas' turn. The Holy Spirit used Barnabas to stand up for Saul. Another author said this, and I think Barnabas had what this author said in spades: it's a great characteristic of the heart of God that he has not held our past sins against us. Barnabas' heart was ready to believe the best in others. Barnabas didn't want to hold Saul's past against him like Jesus forgiving us our sins. Barnabas became the great reconciler for Saul. But still, how could Saul keep going? He has to be so tired at this point, exhausted. The reality of Saul's past has caught up with him, right? Saul is looking at his nemesis. He's looking at all the pain and fear right in the eye, and like Seabiscuit, Saul is running the race of his life, and he's looking at War Admiral straight in the eye. Does he quit? Or does he keep going? The author of Seabiscuit continues. Coming into the backstretch, George Wolfe pulled back ever so slightly on Seabiscuit's reins, just a little bit. Seabiscuit and War Admiral were running side by side in perfect synchronization. Just their feet and their bodies, just perfectly running side by side. Wolf said he could see Seabiscuit looking directly into the eyes of his rival. His ears flattened, and Wolf made a small motion with his hand like this to War Admiral's jockey, Charles Kurtzinger. And the saying became famous: So long, Charlie. So long, Charlie. A phrase that he coined and would be used by jockeys for decades. Seabiscuit won by 4 lengths in that race. Seabiscuit has heart. And this morning in our text, Saul has heart. The church has heart. You and I have heart. A colleague says, there's a score inside of us. A score inside of us to settle. A measure of determination and heart and courage under pressure that matters more than the points on the board. It matters more than winning the race. Winning and losing, apart from that inner score, just don't matter much. Because it is in the struggle, it is in the challenge, that you are offered the opportunity to do your best when your best is required. Saul was at his best preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ when death stared him straight in the eyes. Saul/Paul loved the image of a runner, didn't he not? In Philippians 3, Paul says this. He says, "And one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." In 2 Timothy 4, Paul says, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." Does the church quit when the coronavirus threatens our way of life? Absolutely not. You're here this morning. You're listening online. You're gathering together anyway. Absolutely not. Do we throw away a relationship with God when cancer threatens our life? No. Just talk to Sarah. Talk to so many people in our church. Talk to so many widows and widowers in our church. We do not stop. Do we stop loving when sticks and stones and names are being thrown? No, of course not. We keep on loving. Even if we have the power to do so. Even if we had all the power in the world. If we had the power to do so, like hopping down off the cross of Jesus and destroying everyone, we choose the cross. We choose the path of love and grace, just as Jesus did. Jesus' war admiral was our sin and death itself. And he looked it square in the eye. And Jesus never quit. Jesus never quit. Gordon MacDonald, pastor and author, wrote about a comment someone said about his mother at a funeral. They said this about their mother. Oh, she never finished anything. And Gordon realized that he had this own pattern in his own life. He writes this. It's a sobering thing to realize that you have a quitter's gene in your DNA. In every area of our lives. From Bible reading, to eating healthy, to exercise, to communicating with our spouse, to save instead of spend, to persevere, to love instead of hate, to be generous or be selfish, we are constantly being tempted to quit. We are. We have a war admiral that's come down the stretch, and we sort of look away. We sometimes falter. It's just easier to look away. But the good news this morning, the great news this morning, praise God for this news this morning, is that the Holy Spirit never quits on us. Amen? The Holy Spirit never quits on us. Jesus' disciples in Damascus, they keep going. They work as a church. They work together. They keep training leaders like Saul. They keep pushing them and challenging them. The Jerusalem church and the disciples, they keep going amidst all kinds of fear, and they make sure the church keeps going and the gospel is preached, and it leads them to peace in the land. It's beautiful. They keep encouraging Saul. The Holy Spirit keeps encouraging them and testing them and putting them in a race against themselves to see if they're going to quit loving the world, to see if they're going to quit sharing the gospel. And they don't. They never quit. They never stop. I want to conclude with some reflections I had this past Memorial Day. I couldn't stop thinking about all the loss that we've had in our church just since I've been here, with Anna Holland and Margaret, family members, and specifically, I told myself not to. Okay, give me a second. And there's so many more, and if I'm forgetting some, please forgive me the loss of stuff. But I couldn't help stop thinking about Matt and Carrie Thompson on one day, and you probably were too, and remembering Josie. And I know so many of us have lost loved ones, even in my own family, and I pray about them as well, but Memorial Day is extra tough, and it always will be in my life as a pastor, and I know for folk in our church. You know, but what struck me also as I was thinking about this text, and I finished my text early in the week, and I prayed, and I wasn't sure I was going to include this part, and I called and I asked permission to share, and Max said yes. But what struck me profoundly is that every day War Admiral catches up with Matt and Carrie. And death and sadness look them square in the eye. And only with the Holy Spirit's help, Matt and Carrie can still flatten their ears. And they dig deep. And they hug their kids. And they look in their hearts. And they go to their jobs. And they help out at the Marion food truck, and they deliver food. And they help get the service online for countless weeks during this pandemic. And they continue to serve all the people around them amidst all that pain. What an example. There's so many examples like that in our church. And that is not an easy thing to do. How do you keep loving? How do you keep racing? How do you keep racing and winning that prize amidst the pain? But I think this morning the Holy Spirit is pushing them and challenging them, and us too, to never quit. Sarah Dottie, not quitting. Run the race. Run the race. It doesn't matter if you win or lose. It doesn't matter. It's not about the end points at the end of the game, but it's how you play this game of life right now. Never quit. And remember, the Holy Spirit never quits on us. Amen? Amen? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for never quitting on us. Thank you for the challenges that we face. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunities for our growth and to chance to run hard and endure. Lord, whatever is facing us right now, we ask that you give us the strength to keep loving, to keep moving on, to keep being the people that you want us to be, to becoming more like your Son, Jesus Christ, and transform every day. Lord, help us to never quit our fight against cancer, our fight against tough times in marriage, our fight against just difficult things that we know where you want love and reconciliation and redemption to flourish. Lord, please be with our church and our country. Lord, please be with all the fighting right now, the pain in this world with so many different things, from this virus to racism, to violence, to looting. Lord, what? We need you, oh God, right now more than ever. And thank you, Holy Spirit, for being here this morning and never quitting on us. And in Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite our worship team back up this morning to sing the One Rub It All, both verses, and then to sing Trust and Obey. To trust in that Holy Spirit, to trust in God, to sing verses 1 to 4, and then the first verse of Just a Closer Walk with You.
Thank you.
Outside, and if you want to fellowship, just try to do it safely. Okay? Blessings.